On Tisha B'Av, not only do we discuss the macro tragedies, the destruction of a nation, the destruction of the Beis HaMikdash, the loss of our community, of the autonomy, but on Tisha B'Av as well, we discuss the smaller, the micro tragedies. So last year in our Tisha B'Av video, we spoke about the destruction of the individual, the loss of the individual, the tzaddikim. We're going to be speaking this year about a different micro tragedy, and that is what? The Jewish communities. We're going to be discussing and developing the themes from the Kalir's famous kina, Kina Yud, Eicha Yashva Chavatzelis HaSharon. In the new, the Rabbi Soloveitchik kinos, it can be found on page 269, in English 268, 269, with a commentary running from 276 through 288. It's a very powerful kina. In the art scroll, for those of you who have not yet gotten the Rabbi Soloveitchik kina, it can be found on page 174, Kina Yud, Eicha Yashva Chavatzelis HaSharon. But before we start, if any of you have been to Yad Vashem, and you've experienced something known as the Valley of the Communities, what happens? You go into, it seems, a never-ending maze, where the goal is for you to get trapped, to get lost. What's in that maze? In one part of the maze are the Jewish communities of Galicia. Another part of the Jewish communities of Deutschland, of Germany, of Poland, of Congress Poland. Another is Lithuania, Lita. Another is Belarus, also part of Lithuania. Another is Slovakia, the Marmarushian mountain communities. Another is Transylvania, the Ukraine. Different communities in Europe that were destroyed. And what happens in the Valley of the Communities in Yad Vashem? The major cities are in bigger, bolder print, engraved into the mountains, into the hills of Yerushalayim. The medium-sized communities, their names are a smaller size. In the tiny villages, the Shtetlach, the Dorfs, where the Landsjuden lived in Germany, they're an even smaller, tinier. But what happens? You literally get lost, and you're so overpowered and taken with the fact that there were thousands of Jewish communities, shtetlach, dorfs, towns, villages, cities, major cities, Jewish cities like Warsaw, Lodz, Krakow. And you're taken by the fact that, look at this, you just get overwhelmed just by the number of communities. Now keep in mind, in each and one, every one of these communities, whether it's a Tarnov, a Tarnopol, whether it's a Hamburg, a Würzburg, whether it's a small town, Gaukanexoven, Achalshausen, Aub, small towns in Germany, 40 kilometers from Würzburg, whether it is small towns in the Chust, in the Carpathian Mountains. What are you taken with? That each and every one of these communities had their own minhagim. They had special tunes that they would sing a Shir HaMalos to, that they would sing a Kaddish to, this time of year, that time of year. Every one of these communities had great Talmidei Chachamim. Some of them were Hasidish communities. Some of them were Misnagdish. Some of them, the German communities, went back to the whole Masorah, going back to Rabbeinu Gershom, pre the Rabbeinu Tam and the Balei Tosfos. The communities of Bratislava, you know, following the approach of the Chasam Sofer. The communities in Marmarush, the Carpathians, following the Maram Shik and others. You had in communities in Poland. Some were Misnagdish, some were Zionistic, some were not Zionistic, some of them were Hasidish. In the Ukraine, whether it was a Belz, whether it was a different group of Hasidim. And in Lita, you had part of Vilna following the Masorah of the Gaon, other parts not following the Masorah of the Gaon, etc., etc. What happens is you understand the destruction that took place in the Shoah, the destruction of a tradition, the destruction of a Masorah that was rooted in Chochmah and thought and wisdom, a Masorah that was rooted in feeling and love for God, in love for people, in love for humanity. All of this was taken. Those of you who read the book by Yaffa Eliach and Aishishuk, that small Lithuanian community for 800 years, that was a vibrant Jewish community for 800 years, literally destroyed and wiped out. See, we have something in America that is a real challenge. On the one hand, we have an art scroll sitter that many people use. But what is the challenge of an art scroll sitter? Not that it isn't a fine work, it is a fine work. But the challenge of it is, it's vanilla. It's one Judaism. That's not who and what we are. You look at the Rudelheim sitter, and you see there's a Minhag Frankfurt, there's a Minhag Hamburg, there are other Minhagim, and so on and so forth. And it's true of the Pesach Seder, and it's true of the kinos that were said on Tisha B'Av, and it's true of the piyutim that are said for this holiday during the 4 weeks. It's true of the tunes that were sung leading up to the 3 weeks in Tisha B'Av, the tunes of the high holidays, etc., etc. And all of this is just gone, destroyed. After the bubonic plague, the Black Death, and remember, the Black Death is built upon not only the Black Death, but the effects of five crusades. What were the great achronim, these transition figures between the rishonim and between the achronim? Transition figures like the Maharil, transition figures like the Mari Bruna, Mari Mintz, the Trumas Hadeshen, but particularly the Maharil. He went amongst those who survived the Black Death, the bubonic plague, either that were not killed by the disease itself, or in the case of most Jews that were lost, it was a function of the Christian anti-Semitism, blaming the Jews for the Black Death, saying that we poisoned the wells, saying that when they realized we weren't poisoning any wells, that we cursed the wells, in literally taking out their sorrow and their pain by torturing and killing Jews throughout Austria, throughout Germany, throughout other parts of Europe. The Maharil went and he gathered the Masorah, the traditions of Rothenburg, of Regensburg, of these different communities. And because of the Maharil, we till this day have the tradition, the Masorah of Ashkenazic Judaism. These great transition figures that held up Judaism, how did they hold it up? Not by being Mechadesh, creating new institutions, but particularly by maintaining the Masorah. Look at what was lost then. Look at what was lost in the Shoah. And that is what we're mourning in this kina. What's the particular focus of this kina? The particular focus is the 24 towns. And if it weren't for the Kalir and it weren't for this kina, Echa Yashva Chavatzelas HaSharon, we wouldn't even know of them. From the Gemara, we'd know of four or five. But there were 24 different communities that were centers. These, as you know, there was a system of the Mishmaros, you know it from the Gemara and Tanis, that every 24 weeks, a different group of Kohanim would go to the Beis HaMikdash. Would be involved in the Avoda, would represent the Jewish people. And likewise, along with the Mishmaros, there was a group known as the Ma'amados. They are the Jews from these communities, some of them Yisraelim, Leviim, who would accompany the Kohanim. But what was the idea of the Chafdalad Mishmaros? They represented the Jewish people. They were the leadership, the educators of the Jewish people, the role models, the mentors. If I could borrow a term, we're referred to as the Mamleches Kohanim. V'atem tiyu mamleches kohanim v'goy kadosh. What does Hashem, what does God say to us before the covenant at Har Sinai? It's our job to be role models, to be mentors, to be educators, to influence, to transform, to engage the rest of humanity. Well, if we're the mamleches kohanim, and the definition of a kohen here means a role model, a mentor, a teacher, if we're going to be kohanim to the rest of the humanity, who's going to be our educators? Who will be our teachers? That is the kohanim. And for that reason, the Torah set up a system where we had Chaf Dalad Matnos Kahuna, much of it in part at the end of Parshas Korach, the 24 taxes that we give to the Kohanim, that they don't have to be engaged in commerce and agriculture and business and professions. Their focus can be what? Educating themselves and in turn educating us. The Rav's whole theme of Parshas Emor. Why is it that the Parshas Hamoados, all the teachings and laws of the holidays and Shabbos, are accompanied, are in the same section is the laws of the Kohanim in the Beis HaMikdash? Because the essential role of the Kohen is not to perform the Avodah in the Mikdash. That a Kohen does one day every 24 weeks. That's 2 days a year. Because every Mishmar, which is every 24 weeks, was broken up into seven Batei Av. So as a Kohen, you're only at most going to perform the Avodah one of the 7 days of the week that you're there. And what's the point? So then what does the Kohen do? It gets 24 taxes to work possibly one day every 24 weeks? No. A Kohen works. Their primary role and their primary responsibility is Shabbos and Yom Tov, when the rest of us are not working. But it's throughout the week to teach us, to guide us, to inspire us. And that whole infrastructure, the infrastructure of the Kohanim, was literally destroyed. with the destruction of which a particular attempt was made by the Romans would ultimately be the destruction of, if the shepherds are destroyed, then the flock is lost. That was the attempt. And that is what we're mourning. And I just want to give you one example. Those of you, and many of you have been there hundreds of times, who walk through Shaar Yafo, the famous east-west market or main road in the Eir Atika, in the city of Jerusalem. Or you go through Shaar Shechem, the north-south road, where the two markets, the two main fairs cross in the middle. Think about how long does it take you to walk through the Shuk after you've entered Shaar Yafo to get to Har HaBayis, to get to the Kotel. Those of you who go quickly, it might take you 12, 13 minutes. Those of you who take your time, it might be 25, 30 minutes. Those of you who go at an average pace, it's 16 to 20 minutes. So the whole geshäft, the whole trip from Shaar Yafo to the Har HaBayit is not more than 20 minutes for most of us. Can you imagine? They broke through the walls in Bayis Sheni. The Romans broke through the siege on the 17th of Tammuz. It took them 3 weeks. 3 weeks till Tisha B'Av to enter the Har HaBayis, the Temple Mount. Do you understand what that means? That means that every inch, every centimeter of that city was a battleground. And it was the Kohanim who gave their lives, who were Moser Nefesh. Literally, they're the ones who bore the brunt of the destruction, trying to ward off the Romans. They were hungry, they were ravished, they were famished. Fighting off the Romans, trying to defend Yerushalayim, to defend the Beis HaMikdash, to defend the integrity of the Jewish people. They suffered the most. We're going to go through some of the cities. Many of them you're familiar with. Nazareth is Nazareth in the Galilee. Tzipori, we'll talk about Tzipori in the Galilee. Yudfat. Yudfat, as you know, was the famous city of who? Of which Josephun, or Josephus Flavius, we call him in Hebrew Yosef ben Matisyahu, Josephus Flavius. He was a leader of the Galilean forces. He was a Kohen himself that fought off the Romans. And keep in mind, the war started in 66, 4 years before the temple was destroyed. When we know from the excavations after the miraculous victory of the Six-Day War of Gamla, the community in the Golan Heights, that they write there, that the Battle of Gamla, which they gave their lives for, was really the battle to save Jerusalem. The goal of the Romans was to destroy the Beis HaMikdash, to destroy Jerusalem. It was that way in the Galilee as well. Yudfat, which after a long siege, in the end when they saw they were losing to the Romans, there was a suicide pact. And the Jews of Yudfat committed suicide, the last one being their leader, Josephus Flavius, who did not commit suicide. Halachically, and you'll read that in the Rav's commentary on the Kina, you can say that it was a preferable position. Question it, etc., whether he did the right thing, didn't do the right thing, what his motivations were not clear. He eventually becomes the Roman historian. But what happened? The Jews in Tzipori, which we can go to and visit today, are watching what's happening to their brothers in Yudfat as they're being killed and then the mass suicide and what the Romans are doing to Yudfat. They decide to give over Tzipori to the Romans. But one by one, these centers, and with the fall of Yudfat, was the fall of the Galilee, was the fall of Judea. It made the road to Jerusalem a very quick, easy one for the Romans. These were the Kohanim. These were the people who literally were Moser Nefesh, who gave of their lives. And ultimately, we lost our best, our brightest, our teachers, our role models, our educators. We lost them in these battles. But what's fascinating about this Kina, what's really fascinating about this Kina, is that it doesn't just lament and plead to God, plead to Hashem. How could it be? How could this have happened? How did we give up, you know, our finest? Idis Shebe Idis, the finest of our people. It also is very introspective. It's introspective and it looks deep down at what we did wrong, at the corruptions of the Jewish people, the corruptions in our society that enabled the Romans to succeed. Remember, the Romans were the symptom, not the cause. Their success was a function of our flaws, a function of our corruptions. And that you see in this Kina as well. What we're going to do is take different pieces of this Kina and analyze the communities that were lost. We're going to analyze the flaws of the Jewish people. And many of you who are watching this on the afternoon of Tisha B'Av, we know that a major focus from the morning to the afternoon, the change that takes place at Chatzos, the objective time, according to the Ramah, when you finish saying the Kinos, is that the major motif of the morning is Avelos. It's morning. The major motif of the afternoon is Tshuva. The Avelos subsides, and it's a focus of introspection in Tshuva. Echa Yashva Chavatzelos HaSharon. In the Rebbe Soloveitchik Kinos, it's on page 269 in the Art Scroll 174. V'damam ron mipino se'aron. When you look at the Rav's commentary, who are the people that are referred to as those carrying the Aron? They were silenced. The Rina, the praise and the song of them was silenced. Well, we know that in the Midbar it was Shevet Levi, and in the Beis HaMikdash, the Levim, they sang on the Duchen. We know the story in the second Beis HaMikdash. Literally, they were attacked and killed by the Romans as they were singing the Shira on the Duchen. But since this is the Kina of the Kohanim, many learn this to be referring to who? In fact, the Rambam does. It was the Kohanim. That only the Levim carried the Aron Kodesh. They're the ones who carried it in the Midbar. But once we come into Israel, it's the role of the Kohanim. And as well, we know from Midrashim, which the Rav quotes, the Kohanim would say Shira as they were doing the Avoda. So it could be that Damam Ron Mipi Nose Aron, basic, according to the Rambam, is actually the Kohanim themselves. What is the Chavatzelos HaSharon? That, of course, is referring to the Mikdash, at least based upon the Psukim and Shir HaShirim. It's the place where ultimately the Kohanim, their ultimate role, Ki Mitzion Teitzei Torah, educating not only the Jewish people but humanity, where the Kohanim are, so to speak, center court at Wimbledon. They are there teaching, engaging in teaching the nation, especially on the holidays when we come together to act as one nation. It was the Chavatzelos HaSharon. How can it sit desolate? V'na'u mimishmarosam, Kohanim b'nei Aaron. And the Kohanim, who are supposed to follow in the footsteps of their progenitor, of Aaron, the Ohev Shalom v'Rodev Shalom, the teacher par excellence, the Baal Chesed par excellence, because the role of any teacher is to give, is to look after, is to take care of his people, of his flock. How is it that they have na'u mimishmarosam? They no longer are in their 24 cities spread throughout the length and breadth of the homeland, the length and breadth of Israel, teaching and influencing the Jewish people. B'chol sivcha mechumash svarim, kinerag kohen v'navi b'yom ha-kippurim, v'al damo nishchatu prachim kitzpirim, v'nadu kitziparim kohenei tziparim. What is this referring to? Neharag kohen v'navi an Yom Kippur. This actually did not take place in the Bayis Sheni. This took place in the Bayis Rishon, the first commonwealth, when we had Zechariah, not Zechariah HaNavi from the Bayis Sheni, but Zechariah HaNavi of Bayis Rishon, who was also the Kohen Gadol, who was executed in the Beis HaMikdash on Yom Kippur that fell on Shabbos. A Kohen V'Navi executed on Yom Kippur that falls in Shabbos on the Beis HaMikdash. And the Jewish people never brought to justice this execution. They tolerated it, and we know there's going to be Lamed Dalet, Yom Achbi, a famous kina written by Rabbi Yehuda HaChassid. There's a famous kina Rabbi Yehuda HaLevi wrote a kina Lamed Dalet, that discusses the nature of the consequence of that terrible, terrible sin, and how ultimately the Jewish people paid for that corruption of justice, that notion of, instead of listening and being sensitive to the role of the Navi and to what he was communicating, to try to suppress him by executing him. So don't cry to the Almighty when what? When, as a people, we are not listening, we're not following the role of our educators, our Kohanim, when we're not following their plea or their call to engage in being just, being ethical and moral, a challenge that we face at this time in a very serious way. Our business dealings, the way we pay taxes, the way we treat our employees, the way we market our professions, our businesses, our products, etc. Sticking to our word, holding by a contract. These corruptions, we weren't interested in listening to the Navi. We weren't interested in listening to the Kohen, and we squelched him. And now, in turn, we've lost the Kohanim. Afterwards, it's too late when we don't have the teachers and the role models. Galsa me'artza kala mikushata. The bride, referring to, of course, the image from Shir HaShirim of Hashem being our chatan, our groom, and we being the bride, that intimate relationship that we have with God. We were a beautiful, adorned bride, but that's not what's happened now. Ba'avon maisros shmita. What is the sin of maser and shmita? Maser is referring to the crops, the grain. Shemitah is referring to, of course, the land, what we do with the land. The ultimate sense of control that a person has, the ultimate, you know, sense of confidence and security is our real estate, our home, our real estate, etc. So what happened here? So what happens? Instead of acknowledging it's God's land and all we are is trustees on the land, instead of acknowledging that our income, ultimately we're God's trustees. He's enabled us to use most of that income for our family, ourselves, our needs. But part of that income has to be invested into the poor. Part of that income has to be invested into the Kohanim and Levim to make sure that our educators can survive and that they can educate us. Part of that income is to be invested in Jerusalem, the city of Chachma, of wisdom, that the economy of Jerusalem supported. We didn't do that. And we said, no, it's mine, it's my assets, it's my land. And instead of acknowledging that God is the ultimate owner of that, and that we're essentially tenants or trustees, we did just the opposite. We controlled it, we didn't share, we didn't give, we didn't have a sense of largesse. And now when it's too late, now when we are broken and humbled, it's too late to acknowledge that God is the true owner of the land. And we know this theme. This is a theme that we read in Parshat Bichlkosai. It's a theme that comes up again and again in Yirmiyahu and Yechezkel. It's a theme that comes up throughout the day. Uva'arba'a shvatim hushbata. We were judged with the four shvatim, the four types of execution, the four types of death for different types of corruption and flaws. Ume'edya hushata mishmer nafsheta. Dar chehechal damamu. The roads to Jerusalem. We've uncovered today the whole highway network that existed from all directions, the roads where the pilgrims would go to Jerusalem three times a year, especially on Pesach where the largest crowds would come, but on Sukkot, on Shavuos, that whole city where it was teeming with Jews from all over, from the south, from the north, from the east, from the west, from the diaspora. And what would happen? The Jews would meet each other, come together, one united people. Those highways that were so filled with Jews, excited about the opportunity of spending the holiday as a nation, as a people, they literally are desolate, those roads. Damamu, they're desolate. Va'me'il k'nikra p'silo. We know from Parshas Tetzaveh, the me'il, the special garment that the Kohen would wear, that had, of course, the bells at the bottom and had the pomegranates at the bottom, that special, beautiful garment of tchelet, of turquoise, that one is not allowed to rip. There's an isser. Lo yikareya, it has been ripped. It's been ripped apart by our oppressors who came in and not only took the kelim and the bikte kahuna, but plundered them. Hayu malivim belocham elechem. They mocked the teachers, the locham elechem, those who literally did, their battle was in the world of the intellect, in the world of the spirit. Well, we mock them. And when you mock them and don't appreciate them, you lose them. Givitlu. And we nullified, halo paros lo ra'ev lechem. We're in the fifth stanza. What is the famous phrase, halo paros lo ra'ev lechem? It's from the Haftorah in Yeshaya that we read on Yom Kippur, Perek Nun Ches. What does God want of us? Not a phony fast, a fast which is stale and which is bereft of any meaning and any stirring of the heart. But what does God want of us? To extend out to the poor. To feed the poor, to take care of them, to look after those instead of oppressing those who have less, ultimately to look after and provide for them. But now, v'rovu b'tzamu mimayim u'milechem, now we are famished. We are ravaged from just the basic necessities of mayim and lechem, of water and bread. Kivutlu shtei alechem mibeis lechem. And what's happened? That famous shtei alechem that's brought on Shavuos, you know, of the rich wheat. It's the breadbasket of Israel, the Judean hills, Bethlehem. We know it from the story of Ruth. We know it from the Gemara in Menachos. What happened? We're not able to bring any more the new wheat. Instead of it being a rich, rich, fertile area, the breadbasket, it becomes a barren wasteland, the Judean hills. Vayetzia dar om bakesef nechpas. What was the mistake here? We would cover over with silver. Instead of selling something which we claimed to be silver, it was really silver-plated. And what happened was, again, there was a corruption, cheating in business. Usmura, instead of having that, the silver covering, the silver plating, now what happens? Usmuro eferosha chipas. We're covered over with ashes. You want to put a fake covering on? You'll put a fake covering. Instead of the gleaming, radiant faces of people who are educated, who are engaged, who are passionate about what they do, instead, ultimately, we're in a state of ash and sackcloth. V'neiros nichbu u'menoros nichbas. And what happens? The candles. We'll talk about it later in the Kina, the famous Ne'er Ma'aravi. What does the Rambam say? The sign, the providential sign that Shechina Shora b'Yisrael, that the divine providence, that there's a providential involvement, engagement, looking after the Jewish people. All of that is taken when? When the Ner Ma'aravi, when the Western candle no longer burns. Why the Western candle? Because according to one opinion, all the other candles were facing towards the middle. In this Western candle, the wick of it was to the west, facing the Holy of Holies. Another opinion is it was, the reason it's called Ner Ma'aravi, it was just west of the easternmost candle. But either way, that Western candle, the notion of the west is the place of the Shechina. The further west you go into the temple compound, the closer you get to the Holy of Holies. That idea of the hashgacha, the, so to speak, the perceived presence of God, that intimate perceived presence of God, was taken from us. Turning over to page 271, the seventh stanza. Zachra zaman asher nasa v'nishma heshivu. There's a contrast here. What happened? Remember, God, we ask Hashem to remember when we committed ourselves. Even though we had a great understanding of the system, we didn't know every detail, we didn't know all of the Taryag, but we were so committed to God, into a relationship with God, an eternal relationship, that for the covenant we'd said, we don't need to see every detail. Once we have the principles of Parshas Mishpatim, and once we have the principles of Shabbos and the holiday of Pesach, we know Mishpatim, we know Eidos, and some of the Chukim that come up that we learned about in Parshas Mishpatim, and the Paraduma that we learned about at Mara. We have a sense of the chukim, the mishpatim, the eidos, nasev nishma. We commit ourselves to the system in totality. That's a commitment. And in contrast to that, vata onos amen lo avu. We refuse to answer amen. In other words, what? We rejected the words of the prophets. We rejected the bracha that God is the ultimate source of blessing. No, it's kochi votzem yadi. God's irrelevant. What does God have to do with this? The people said. Instead of a commitment, a passion, a rendezvous, we kept God out of our lives. So if we don't want a Hashem in our lives, if we're going to act with God in a state of carry, in a sense of, you know, that God is happenstance, that God is not relevant, then ultimately God removes himself. And when Hashem removes that providential protection, what happens? Destruction. Then our enemies get the best of us. Then the weather, then natural forces get the best of us, and we're wiped out. Chet chata v'amra le'eliel ze'el. A great sin did we do by saying that this Eliel, this is a god. What did we do? We mocked. We totally viewed them as irrelevant, as a joke, the Chozekel, the prophets of God. And what did we do? Avor Kain Hukna Abamargizel. We enraged God with fake gods. And fake gods is not just primitive pagan idols, it can mean different philosophies. Think about how many Jews invested their whole lives in communism and what was the end and what did they get for that. So the phrase hukna, in other words, the notion of that there's going to be a jealous response, what it means is midas hadin. In other words, when we engage in corrupt ideologies, when we engage in false ideologies, so the providential response is midas hadin, is a very harsh and strong response. And that, of course, is what we suffered. Tumasa hechanifa tsevel. We basically, hechanifa has two meanings here. It means that we stained and we made putrid and sullied with tuma the world. Here tevel is referring to the land of Israel. But hechanifa is from the word chanifa, also with flattery. In other words, with ingratiation, not leading a life of truth and integrity, but a life of ingratiation and flattery. That's how we conducted affairs. And therefore, v'na'ala rav hachovel. The master of the ship, the one who ultimately was running Israel, the Almighty, he removed himself. Va'anan avak raglav ke'ovel. And now what? Now we are in a state of mourning. V'ein miskarbel b'ko'anei arbel. Arbel, as you know, we've talked about Nazrat, we've talked about Beit Lechem. Arbel, of course, is the mountain overlooking the Kinneret. Yado paras tsar beveis zvul. The oppressor extended his control over Beis Zvul, the Beis HaMikdash. Ki klaya chuyavti kedor hamabul. See, really the Rav says, the Midas HaDin is, we should have been annihilated, because we corrupted and perverted ourselves. Instead of acting as a mamlechas kohanim, instead of learning from the kohanim, instead of the kohanim acting as teachers and role models, which not all of them did, We corrupted and perverted all the opportunities God gave us. And we should have been chuyavti kelaya. We should have been chayv annihilation, like the Dor HaMabul. But what happened? Instead, hishlich kaso, God, so to speak, cast his anger, meaning anger here doesn't mean God doesn't get angry. You know, these are terms that we use. We use human terms, Dibra Torah b'lashon b'nei Adam, Dibra Tanakh b'lashon b'nei Adam. Hishlach ka'aso means he employed the midas hadin be'etzim u'vavanim, on the sticks and stones, meaning on the structure. The Beis HaMikdash was destroyed. The Beis HaMikdash was destroyed, and we were saved. We survived, even though alpi midas hadin we should have been destroyed. And of course, the Rav, this is a theme that comes up again and again in the Kinos. That's why the description is Mizmor la'asaf. Why is it Mizmor? The Medrash asks, the Gemara asks, it should say Kina la'asaf. Asaf is saying a lamentation. What is a Mizmor, a psalm of praise? The fact is we're praising God. That even in our time of destruction, God used the Midas HaRachamim. God used Midas HaChesed. Instead of destroying us and annihilating us, what did he do? Just the opposite. He allowed us to survive. He allowed us to survive, to regroup, to do tshuva, to rebuild and recreate ourselves in the way we should be. So what's the idea here? The idea is this, that if you notice on Tisha B'Av, the intensity of the mourning, it actually subsides, M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G. The intensity of the Avelis of the morning, it subsides in the afternoon. Why is that? Why is it that it subsides in the afternoon? Because in the afternoon is when the destruction took place. So we should say just the opposite. The Rav asked, Pum Faker, just the opposite. That should be a greater state of intensity. No, the point is, the fact that Hishlich Kasol Eitzim Vavanim, the fact that God imposed, so to speak, the destruction on a building, on a structure, and not on the people, not on the Jewish nation, that in itself is Chatzi Nechama. That in itself enables us to say Nachem, that God should comfort and console us, because there is a state of comfort and console. That in itself is a moed. As you know, Tisha B'Av is referred to as a moed. What's a celebratory, we don't celebrate, how can you call Tisha B'Av a moed, a time of holiday, of coming together? No, we come together to acknowledge and express our gratitude that even in our worst corruption, ultimately God gave us a chance to rebuild and repair ourselves. That's the moed. That's the notion of nechama and less of a less intense mourning, M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G, in the afternoon. We're going to Ayin. Al gabi charshu charshim. Over me, meaning over the Temple Mount, the plowers have plowed it. Ve'arichu manis. What is the idea here? We know that Hadrian, and there was a custom the Romans would have when they would conquer a city, they would symbolically show that they've controlled it by taking a team of oxen and doing a circular around the circumference, plowing around the circumference. That's one idea. But literally here, we know from history that Hadrian, they literally took meters off of the Temple Mount. After the Bar Kokhba revolt, they literally plowed off meters off of the Temple Mount to say as if it will never be rebuilt. They put a Roman idol there. They renamed it Aurelia Capitolina. And you know from that point, the Byzantines made it into a church. And the Muslims, when they conquered it from the Christians, they made it into a mosque. And this is part of the pain and sorrow that we feel. Even today, when we have the great opportunity, we actually can get that close. We can come to the Kotel. When you go to the Kotel HaKatan in the Muslim quarter of the Ir Atika, and when you go to the point where Muslims can enter, we don't because it's the Har HaBayis, and you look there. And it's so painful because you're so close. A closeness that our great-grandparents never even dreamed that they would be able to attain. They prayed three times a day for it. We have it. We have that access. But you get so close, and yet it's sometimes even more painful. Why? When you see what exists there, when you see what should exist there, when you feel, you hear the pain and the bitterness that comes out of what they preach every Friday on the Temple Mount, and when you see the way that they look at us and despise us, it's our place, it's our intimate place with God, and yet look what sits there. Whether it was what the Romans did, what the Christians did afterwards, whether it's what the Muslims have there today. And that's a very, very painful experience, extremely painful experience, because we're so close and yet so far. Al gabi chorshu choshim. V'heiriku alai cherev v'chanis. What did the Romans do? They took the sword out of the scabbard and they came after us with the spear and sword. Virbesit somos vitanis. And as a function of this, many, many fasts were observed. Till this day, we still observe four fasts every year, four fast days every year. Mitzuras tochnis yatsa yavanis. See, all of the other cities are communities. The question is, what is Yavnit or Yavanit? Is Yavnit, was it the name of a town? That's one possibility. Or Yavanit, mean it's referring to what? It's a function of the Greek influence, the Hellenistic influence, that ultimately led to many of the tragedies and led to many of the downfall of the Jewish people. That's the question. Tzadik, we're on the Tzadik. Tzadiku Hashem kifi umaras. That's the famous quote from Eicha, right? When we make the rest of the kina until now, we've pleaded with God, we've called out to God, acknowledging as we called out to God, acknowledging our corruptions that led to the destruction. But here we do tzidok adin. We do it explicitly. Tzadiku Hashem kifi umaras. Ultimately, we rebelled against God. Whether it was rebelling against the Torah, whether it was rejecting what Yirmiyahu, what Yechezkel were teaching us, it was a rejection. In the Ba'isheni, rejection of what our Chachamim were teaching us, what the Kohanim were trying to teach us. And in place, what did we get? Ve'aru aru ad yasod ba'aras. That ultimately, the temple was. This is a quote from Psalm 137, Kapitel Kuf Lamed Zayin, that what? The temple was overthrown. It was overthrown. Usamir Usamur, in place of Ozi Vizimras, the famous Shira that we said, when we saw the hand of providence, the hand of God, functioning as our military, Hashem Ish Milchama, just the opposite. Kinim Aleha Necharas. It's lamentations that ultimately we ended up saying. Instead of Shira V'tishbachos, it's Kinos that we end up saying. Uvekatzvei Eretz Nizras Mishmeres Nazras, Nazareth. Karati Batsar, the Kuf. I called out in the state of oppression, velo karav, and Hashem did not come close. Vekonanti bayar ba'arav. What happened? The refugees, the Jewish refugees of the Bayis Rishon, we went to our cousins, to the Arabs, and we hoped that they would take us in and look after us, but just the opposite. They fed us salty food, and instead of giving us drinks, they gave us these flogs that had air, canteens that had air in them. And ultimately, it did damage to our intestinal system. Many of us died. Instead of finding refuge, which they had offered us, it was just the opposite. It was more death, decimation. V'chava ner hadolek b'marav, that western candle that the Rambam says, again, is Shechina Shrura b'Yisrael. Ultimately, with that western candle, it extinguished. It was a sign that that specific providential relationship that existed between God and the Jewish people, that was manifest on the Temple Mount. Ultimately, Hashem removed himself. Na'ale Rav HaChovel, as we said before. V'reach lo arav, ma'achal arav. Our smell was not pleasant. The reach nichoch of the korbanos ceased to exist. Re'e ki husarti ka'aniya b'sa'aniya v'aniya. The Jewish people, we are storm-tossed people. This is a quote from Yeshaya. It's an allusion to the description you have in Yonah, and we have moaning and groaning. Vadasi katzon latevach menuya, and the Jewish people are like sheep being led to the slaughter. That's the way we're being counted out, like you take the animals in the slaughterhouse. In Nebuch, that's what's become of the Jewish people. Vinoa mechanuya, migdal nuniya. And what's happened? We have from our state of being encamped in a beautiful way, in a way where the Kohanim were the center, and it spread out to the four Degolim. And if you notice, that's the way that the Jewish people encamped originally in the land of Israel. The way that we encamped in the Machaneh, that is ultimately how the Shvatim existed in Israel, with the base of Mikdash before that Mishkan Shiloh in the middle, and all of that is gone. And we're a group of refugees. We're a group of people who've been storm-tossed from one part of the world to another part of the world. And we have never found rest. The Yonah lo matza manoach. The Yonah always referred to, which is always analogous with the Jewish people. Ultimately, we've never found rest. The Shin, shamu kinis hamti batzachana v'sasa meni techina. What's happened? The prayer that we've attempted to plead to the Almighty has been sealed off, referring to the third parak of Eicha, where Yirmiyahu says, sasam tfilasi. My prayer has been sealed off. What's happened? We no longer again, no longer live in our cities, where ultimately our kohanim can become educators. We're going to stop the text at this point and conclude. This theme of the loss of the communities, this theme of each of those wonderful special communities that had its own special traditions, educators, tunes, customs, these communities that made up the life force, that made up that beautiful, beautiful tapestry that makes the Jewish people. One by one they were plucked, and that happened again and again in history. We spoke about what happened to the communities of Ashkenaz as a function of the five crusades and the bubonic plague, the Black Death. And we know for sure, just using the analogy from the Valley of the Communities at Yad Vashem, what happened to European Jewry and the loss of those communities, the tragedy of the loss of those communities. And ultimately the richness that the Jewish people had, the 31 flavors, each one of those flavors with its own distinct special characteristic, we've lost that. And we mourn that as much as we mourn the macro destruction, because that's what made the Jewish people, that's what shaped the Jewish people. And we pray to God that ultimately we can restore these minhagim, we can restore the communities, that we go back to the Nuskhe HaTfila that we had, the special text that each and every community had. We go back to those special minhagim that made the holidays so rich, that made our weddings and our smachot so rich, that made the mourning period so meaningful, whether it was a shiva, private mourning, or whether it was other times, and that made the anticipation and the yearning and the building for certain times of the year, certain holiday seasons, that made it so powerful and so meaningful. Ultimately, we pray that God restore the beauty, the richness of this. And ultimately, we pray that here on Tisha B'Av, the afternoon where the focus is tshuva, that ultimately we do tshuva for our corruptions, and that we appreciate our teachers, we appreciate our Balei HaMasorah, our role models, and what they have to offer us, and ultimately what makes our life worth living, the beauty of the Torah, the beauty and richness of its customs, its traditions, and the beauty and the richness of its teachings, the teachings that existed from all corners of Eastern Europe, from all corners of Western Europe, that were wrenched from us, that were taken from us, that we, this Tisha B'Av, we the mourners of the Shoah, we the mourners of Ashkenaz, we the mourners of the Mishmarot HaKahuna, that ultimately that can be restored. Amen.